أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محموما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه. يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم رأس الأمر الإسلام. The head of the matter, the most important matter in existence, is for one to be a Muslim. We as Muslims need to be keen about protecting our investment, which is what the Prophet ﷺ described as this is our capital, this is the head of the matter. In the Quran, we see that our ibadah, our acts of worship in relation to rest of the ayat that talk about other matters that are far more important than just making that ibadah in an actionable matter. We see that the ayat that speak about ibadah, approximately 110 ayat. And rest of the Quran, which total ayat, 6,237 ayat. So if you take the ratio of 110 to 6,237 ayat, you'll see it's a ratio of 1 to 62. So subhanAllah, everything that we do day in and day out is 1 over 62. So what is the significance of our ibadah in relation to the remaining parts that are mentioned in the Quran? In the hadith, we learn that a man, a Bedouin, came to the Prophet ﷺ when he heard about the messenger of Islam, and he said, O Prophet of Allah, what were you sent with? He said, I was sent with 5 daily prayers in one night and one evening. And he said, what else? He said, I was sent with fasting the month of Ramadan. So the man would ask, and the Prophet ﷺ would answer. So the man made a commitment. He said, I will do exactly what you were sent with. And he's referring to the obligatory acts of worship. No more. Meaning that Salat al-Dhuhr is 4 fard. He's not going to do the nafilah. He's not going to do the sunnah. Salat al-Maghrib is 3 fard. He's not going to do the extra 2 nafilahs. So when the man left, the Prophet ﷺ made a comment. In one narration, أَفْلَحَ إِنْ صَدَقْ. He's going to be successful if he is truthful. Now, is the Prophet ﷺ here speaking about just salah? Is he speaking about just siyam? Just hajj? No. He's not speaking about 1 over 62 of the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ is speaking about what salah is supposed to do, and what siyam is supposed to do, and what hajj and what zakah are supposed to do for the person. I'll explain. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ادْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةً وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطْوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُّبِينٌ. All you who believe, embrace Islam collectively, at large. You cannot be picky and choosy. And similarly, he gives us examples of prior nations where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is condemning and criticizing those who believe in part of the Quran or part of the book or part of the revelations they received, and they disbelieve in other parts. The Quran was given to us as one unit, one system to follow in its entirety. If we pick and choose, part of the ayah that talks about those who are the greatest of loss shall apply to us. Part of that ayah shall apply to us. Here in this ayah that we just mentioned, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do you believe in part of the book and you disbelieve in the rest of it? فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ مِنْكُمْ. So he's telling us beforehand how this person is going to be reckoned, one who believes in part of the book and rejects the rest. إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. A life of disgrace in this dunya. وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ شَدِّ الْعَذَابِ. And on the day of judgment, they shall be returned to the worst of punishments. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indeed is aware and never oblivious of that which we do. Now, let's talk first about the ibadah and what nullifies the ibadah right off the start. We learn from the hadith that one who prays with the pillars of salah, establishing the pillars, the conditions, and the sunnah, and achieves khushu', which is the amount of reward that we receive for our salah is proportionate to our level of khushu'. It means that our concentration, our internalization, our communication with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a present heart and a present mind, reflected upon the ayat that we are reciting. And meaning every word that we say as we make our moves into the salah from standing up to ruku' to sujood. If you perfect that, you get 10 out of 10. But the Prophet ﷺ says, some will get 10 out of 10, some will only get 50%, some will only get a quarter of that or less, some will get nothing. So those who perfect their salah, they get the full ajr. It's wrapped up in a white garment, is raised up to the heavens, and it's got this beautiful scent, and it will say, your salah, your prayer will say, حَفِظَكَ اللَّهُ كَمَا حَفَظْتَنِي. May Allah protect you just like you protected me. As for one who's going through the actions, no khushu', doesn't have the fiqh, the understanding of how to pray, a lot of movements, a lot of distractions, and when they're done, just like the moment they've entered, no benefit whatsoever has been materialized. As for that, his salah is wrapped up in an old black garment that does not reach up high, comes down and strike him in the face. And what will say, ضَيَّعَكَ اللَّهُ كَمَا ضَيَّعْتَنِي. May Allah waste you, just like he wasted me. So here's a reason why a salah is not accepted. Another reason, and I'm just mentioning a few examples here. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says that three people, their salah is not lifted above their heads, not even the span of a hand. The span of a hand. The first of which, عَقِّلْ walidain, one who is neglectful and ungrateful for the service that his parents or her parents have given to them, and in their old age, they abandon them, or they speak rudely to them, or they abuse them, or they deny, you know, their favors over him, which is an act of ibadah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has obligated us to be, practice utmost bir and utmost words of kindness and best of behavior towards our parents, to the extent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbidden us from saying the word uff, which is just a sound that we make that we are, you know, overburdened by this responsibility. Just that sound we've been prohibited from saying. So this is one person that his salah is not accepted right off the start. Another person, mudmin al-khamr, one who drinks alcohol regularly. His salah is not even, in other words, they're just wasting time. Their salah is not being uplifted, not even the span of a hand above their heads. The third of which is very unfortunate, but we see that prevalent in the Muslim Ummah now, is a man with the Prophet ﷺ named him Dayuth. A Dayuth is a person who has no jealousy over their family. They see their sisters, they see their wife, they see their mother, their relatives out there without the proper Islamic attire. In other words, wearing revealing clothing, wearing the makeup, wearing the perfume, and they move nothing to stop that. In fact, some of them, they may even feel proud that they're emulating the others and they're being neglectful to that. So these are three different situations that the Prophet ﷺ mentions to us, that even if you pray, your salah is not going to be accepted. Now we just focused on that segment of 1 over 62. Want to make sure that this, at least, when we offer it, that it's intact. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, لا خير في صلاة لا تنهى عن فحشاء ولا منكر. There is no good in a salah that is not gonna stop you from committing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made forbidden, be it the greater form or the smaller form of sin. The smaller form for those who insist, and the greater form which requires, you know, independent and specific tawbah from each act. Now we go to another pillar in Islam, the pillar of Hajj. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, الركب كثير والحج قليل. When people go for Hajj, الركب meaning that those who are traveling for Hajj from all over the world, there's so many. And now we see them, they're in the millions. But then he says, والحج قليل, but those who perform the Hajj are few. Why is that? One of which is that we don't pay attention to how to perform the Hajj. We don't take the time to learn every step of the way. We don't take the time to learn the purpose of performing the Hajj. We see that if you go over the ayat of Hajj in the Quran, You'll see وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ وَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ عِنْدَ الْمَشْعِرِ الْحَرَامِ وَذْكُرُوا. So the purpose of all these rituals is to have a heart that is often remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That instead of wajal, instead of khushu', instead of fear, instead of hope, this is what Hajj is supposed to accomplish. That's why you find sometimes people coming from Hajj in a complete transformation. And others, they're coming back, I performed the Hajj, I'm done with it, I'm glad it's over with. This person didn't understand what Hajj is all about. Another reason why Hajj is not accepted, when a person stands at his front door and ready to part ways with his family to go for the Hajj, they will say, لَبَّيْكَ اللَّهُمَّ حَجَّ. Oh Allah, I am responding to your call for Hajj. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond, لَا لَبَّيْكَ وَلَا سَعْلَيْكَ. There is no talbiyah for you, there is no acceptance for you out of the start. Why? مَالُكَ حَرَامٌ وَمَطْعَمُكَ حَرَامٌ وَمَشْرَبُكَ حَرَامٌ وَدَابَّتُكَ حَرَامٌ. Or كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The wealth that, or the money that you're using for this trip is from unlawful means. The clothing you wear is from unlawful means. The ticket that you bought on the airplane or on a bus or whatever is from unlawful means. What you're going to eat while you're performing the Hajj is from unlawful means. So how is this Hajj going to be accepted? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us right at the start, إِنَّ اللَّهَ طَيِّبٌ لَا يَقْبَلُ إِلَّا طَيِّبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all pure, the all good. And He's not going to accept anything from us except that which is all pure and that which is all good. So in the collective sense of the word, if we understand ibadah to mean a vehicle or vehicles that are designed for us to achieve tazkiyah, which is the condition and the criterion for success in this dunya and the hereafter, we begin to have a better understanding of how to perform our ibadah and the higher objective behind performing these ibadah, which is to achieve that tazkiyah. So if you understand that you are trying to purify yourself and achieve the tazkiyah by performing these ibadah, you want to make sure that you're doing it according to the sunnah. And you want to make sure that every penny you spend on your ibadah, which all of them require money to be spent on, it is coming from halal means, from halal sources. Okay? Similarly, if we talk about zakah, people now have jobs in all fields. Some work in the banking system, which is the riba system, which is highly prohibited. We mentioned that in the hadith in the previous halaqah. As-sab' al-mubiqat. The seven destroying sins, and one of which is akl al-riba, dealing with riba. So you find that they have loans for business, and they have loans for homes, and they have loans for this and that. And all of their lives is just basically loans and making money off of loans and this. This is a sin that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised a severe punishment for in this dunya and in the hereafter. So how are you going to pay zakah on riba? Riba is prohibited to begin with, it's not your money. So whether you pay zakah on it or not, it's not going to be accepted. Now, similarly when it comes to fasting the month of Ramadan. Fasting the month of Ramadan is not just stopping from, you know, the break of dawn to sunset, season the act of eating, drinking, and intimate relationships. No. The Prophet ﷺ tells us in the hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not in need of someone's siyam, leaving their food and their water aside. مَا لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ. If they do not stop speaking or giving false testimony, or witnessing false accounts and false incidents and not moving anything, not taking any action to change that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He's not in need of this type of fasting. And this person did not understand what fasting is all about. They think it's just leaving you food and water. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala right off the start says, يَا أَيُّهَا آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So all these vehicles, siyam is ordained and decreed upon us just like it was decreed and ordained on prior generations so that we achieve taqwa. And what is taqwa? Huh? Taqwa has been defined in so many different ways. But in the general sense, the imam of the linguistic abilities, Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said, taqwa al-ridha bil-qaleel, wal-amalu bil-tanzeel, wal-isti'adadu lil-rahim. Al-khawfu min al-jaleel, wal-ridha bil-qaleel, wal-amalu bil-tanzeel, wal-isti'adadu lil-rahim. Al-khawfu min al-jaleel, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always in your mind and your heart. Which means it's the energy that's driving you to watch your actions. How you earn a living, how you treat people, how you deal with your family, how you fulfill your obligations in every aspect of your life. How you stay away from that which is forbidden. How you attain that which is obligatory. How you even pursue that which is permissible in moderation. All of that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is present in your mind and your heart at all times. وَالْرِضَى بِالْقَلِيلِ To be content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Many people are just day in and day out. They're just going after money. And no matter how much they pile up, it's never enough. It's never enough. And unfortunately, they're doing this at the expense of that which is obligatory upon them. That which is obligatory. So here, being content with that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon us, it doesn't mean that I shouldn't do my best, but I cannot do my best seeking my sustenance at the expense of my ibadah. I cannot seek that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guaranteed for me at the expense of that which He had made obligatory upon me, which is to worship Him and to serve Him and to purify myself and so on and so forth. So there is no harm, it's a ibadah to seek after your sustenance, but not at the expense of that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made obligatory. Now, if we fulfill all these ibadat, we have fulfilled 1 over 62 of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Now, what are some things that in spite of doing all of our ibadat correctly, according to the sunnah, salah, siyam, hajj, zakah, all of that, what are the detriments that can nullify all of this? It's mentioned in the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was in the circle of knowledge with the companions, he said, shall I tell you about al-muflis, the broke one? Or can you tell me who the muflis is? Who do you consider among you to be one who is bankrupt? So the Sahaba said, in the money language, مَنْ لَا دِرْهَمَ وَلَا دِينَارَ لَهُ One who has neither a dirham, a currency, a unit of currency, or a dinar, which is a greater value of that currency. He said, no. He said, al-muflis, the bankrupt one, is the one who comes on judgment day. وَقَدْ صَانَ وَصَلَّ So he prayed, he fasted, did the hajj, did it. But these vehicles did not produce the taqwa in him. Did not produce the tazkiyah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the self-purification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed these ibadat in order for us to achieve. So as a result, what they do? فَسَفَكَ دَمَ هَذَا He killed this person, and he hurt that person, and he oppressed the other, and he cursed the fourth, and so on and so forth. So on judgment day, all of these are debtors. Now they're going to collect on this debt. So they come on judgment day, and there are no dirhams and there are no dinars. You've taken money in this dunya, there's no money in the hereafter. There's hasanat and there's sayyat. So all these people will gather and they will start taking from his hasanat until he runs out. What happens next? If the debt hasn't been paid, they start giving him from their sayyat. And then he's taken and flung upon his face in the hellfire of Iyadu Billah. This is the true bankrupt person. So we can do all of these ibadat, but if we fail to understand the purpose of the legislation of these ibadat, and even if we were to perform it perfectly, as this Bedouin claimed to the Prophet ﷺ, that I shall do it perfectly, I will not increase, meaning that I'm not going to pray the nawafil, I'm not going to do the extra acts of worship, and I will not decrease. And that's almost impossible for someone to be able to do this. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the Prophet ﷺ as a messenger of mercy. And we are fallible, and we are deficient. No one can stand up and make a statement that I prayed my 4 rak'ahs this evening, I prayed my 4 isha rak'ahs this evening perfectly. I was not distracted. I was fully focused on the ayat. I was fully focused on my ruku' and my sujood, and I've made my dua and so on and so forth. So this is impossible. So here, on judgment day when the salah is looked at first, right? If it's deficient, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at the nawafil, looks at qiyam al-layl, looks at other salawat and other ruku' and sujood to make up for that which He has made obligatory upon us. So this is an act of mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this Prophet of mercy to teach us that we can do beyond that which is obligatory. Similar with siyam. We all make errors, we all say things, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala translated zakat al-fitr, So this way it will wipe out whatever vain talk or things that we said we did not intend. And of course the additional, you know, fast on Mondays and Thursdays, al-ayyam al-bid, the 13th, 14th, and 15th of the lunar calendar of every month, the day of Ashura, the 9 days of Dhul-Hijjah. So all of these pile up into our accounts. But what's important is to protect our capital. Our capital is the obligatory acts of worship. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to accept the nafila before you render that which is obligatory. In other words, if someone doesn't pay their zakah, and every now and then they give sadaqah, even if this sadaqah amounts to the amount of zakah they're supposed to pay, let's say they have $10,000, and they pay on that $250, but they don't want to pay the zakah. Say, I'm not going to pay the zakah, I'm just going to give sadaqah. And over the course of the year, they gave $2,000 in sadaqah without the intention of giving zakah. That is not accepted because the obligatory has to be rendered. Similarly, somebody is doing qiyam al-layl. I'm going to just, you know, we pray 2 for fajr, 4 for dhuhr, 4 for asr, 3 for maghrib, 4 for isha. They combine these 17, okay, I'm going to pray them all at night. That's not acceptable. That's qiyam al-layl. That's a sunnah. It's a nafilah. What you have to do is the faridah. You know, we can't say don't do qiyam al-layl. We can't tell the sister who's not wearing the hijab, don't fast Mondays and Thursdays. But we tell her this is not where we start. We start with the obligatory act of worship, and then we move on to other, you know, to other ibadat, to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because in the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, what is roughly translated, that my abd cannot come close to me in ways that I like, except with that which I've made obligatory upon him first. And then he or she will continue to come closer and closer to me by way of nawafil. So nawafil are second place. Okay? Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves him. And then he commands Jibreel alayhi salam, the archangel Jibreel alayhi salam, to love him. And then Jibreel alayhi salam would command everyone in the heavens to love this individual. And they would love him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَيُوضَعَ لَهُ الْقَبُولَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. So he becomes accepted among the righteous, that is. He or she become accepted among the righteous on earth, and this is a good sign. This is a good sign. But again, we always have to maintain a balance between khawf and raja, fear and hope. Because there are interpretations for everything. Sometimes people will see that they're gaining popularity. Ask yourself a question. Is this something making you feel good, or are you going back to the hadith and to the Quran and saying, perhaps this is a sign of qabool? Insha'Allah. And you would say, Insha'Allah. Or you would also look at the other warning hadith where it says that a person can be delivering, you know, words of wisdom and explaining ayat and explaining a hadith to people, and they are not applying it to themselves. So they become like what? A bridge, wal'iyadu billah, over the hellfire. People cross over him and he dips into the hellfire. So you want to make sure that whatever, of course you can't do this 100%. A khatib or an imam or a speaker, whatever, they cannot apply everything they say. That's impossible. That is impossible. But you have to look at the biggest bulk of what you say. Are you applying this? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned those in Surah Al-Baqarah, أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. You command people to practice birr and to do righteous deeds, and to become pious and achieve taqwa, and you forget about yourself. And subhanAllah, because of our ignorance, you hear this from, you know, parents sometimes. So yeah, I'm keen about teaching my child the Qur'an, and I wake him up for fajr, and I do this and I do that for my children, but I don't pray. What kind of an understanding of Islam is this? You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. Your child is not going to intercede on your behalf unless you qualify. And the qualification is to have that capital, which is the Islam we're talking about, the ibadah. There are other detriments that could yield one to be a bankrupt, especially for those who do not take the time to learn the aqeedah and to understand that learning the aqeedah is a lifelong journey. And I don't repeat the speech that I've, you know, said before, but the first item on the list that will definitely wipe out all of our ibadat and all of our hasanat is shirk. And oftentimes, we are not paying attention to that. And oftentimes, we feel safe and secure from shirk. But in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, there's nothing I fear more for you than shirk. فَإِنَّهُ أَخْفَى مِن دَبِيبِ النَّمْلِ. It is more hidden than the sound of the footsteps of an ant. None of us can hear the sound of the footsteps of an ant. It doesn't matter how good your hearing is, you can't hear it. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu got concerned. Imagine this number two man after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, O Prophet of Allah, what do we do? He said, Qulu, say, Allahumma inna na'udhu bika min an nushrika bika shay'an na'lamu wa nastaghfiruka lima la na'lam. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching them something precious to say. Say, Allah, we seek refuge in you, that we commit shirk in you in ways that we know. In other words, without your protection, even if we know, we're still going to commit shirk. But with your protection, that's the only help we can, you know, seek, and that's the only way for us not to commit shirk of things that we know. وَنَسْتَغْفِرُكَ لِمَا لَا نَعْلَمُ. And we seek forgiveness of you of that which we erred in doing. We made mistakes. Sometimes we say things, statements of shirk, wal-iyadu billah, but we don't mean it. But from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He has forgiven this ummah that which it had forgotten and that which it had erred in doing. In other words, it is not intended to be said that way. And if it came out the wrong way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives that. لا يؤاخذكم الله باللغو في أيمانكم. If someone has gotten used to saying, Allah, swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they really don't mean to swear. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you are pardoned when you're doing this. This is a human weakness. However, He holds you responsible for what your heart has intended to do. And the only one who can see what the heart has intended to do is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a word of caution for us, because also in the hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us at the time of His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the heart of the believer is between the two fingers of Ar-Rahman, the All Gracious. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam oftentimes used to supplicate, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulubi thabbit qalbi ala deen. O you who turns the hearts, hold my heart steadfast upon your deen. I will conclude with this one. Everything that we do, believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the right way, in the angels, in the divine revelations, learning, reading, understanding, and memorizing the Quran, learning, understanding, and following the sunnah, all of that, we do that for what reason? So our dua is accepted. So our dua is accepted. Our supplication is accepted. And the best of supplications that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taught us, Allahumma atina fi dunya hasan, wa fi al-akhirati hasan, wa qina adab al-nar, wa qina adab al-qabr, wa qina sharra fitnati al-mahya wal-mamat, wa qina sharra fitnati al-masih al-dajjal. If you are protected from these and you're given that which you asked for, a hasana, that which is good in this dunya, in terms of your normal life and your religious life, which they are intertwined. وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا. The akhirah hasana means protection from the hellfire and entering into, by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, into paradise and seeing the blessed face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in paradise. That's the hasana of the dunya and the hasana of the hereafter. وَقِنَا عَذَابِ النَّارِ, which is the protection of the punishment of the fire. وَقِنَا عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ, the protection from the tribulations and the punishment of the grave. وَقِنَا شَرَّ فِتْنَةِ الْمَحْيَا وَالْمَمَاتِ, the tribulations of this dunya and the time of naz'a, when the soul part ways with the body. When we come and we're tested by, you know, Satan, la'anahu Allah, who's going to come and tell you, you know, just believe in me and I shall relieve you from the agony that you are undergoing. وَقِنَا شَرَّ فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ, and the tribulation of the false Messiah, which is, you know, a tribulation of utmost importance, because every messenger and every prophet has warned his respective people from this tremendous fitna. From this tremendous fitna. So if we achieve all of that, that means our ibadah is accepted. Because the only reason why we'd achieve this, why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it, is that because our ibadah is good. And we have achieved a certain level of taqwa and piety and purity that is acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we achieve that, then we are in good shape. We are, inshallah, on our way to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya and in the hereafter. But what prevents the dua from being accepted is in the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talks about the Bedouin who's traveling. And notice, in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling us all the reasons why a dua is being accepted. And then the only reason why this dua was not accepted. ثم ذكر الرجل, in this hadith that we mentioned, in Allah طيبٌ لا يقبلُ إلا طيبٌ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all pure and does not accept that which is pure. And he has commanded the believers with that which he has commanded his chosen people, the prophets and the messengers. All you messengers and prophets, eat from that which we have put out for you, which is lawful. وَشْكُرُوا لِلَّهِ And give due gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, roughly translated. ثُمَّ ذَكَرَ الرَّجُلُ Then he mentioned the person. يُطِيلُ السَّفَرُ Traveling for a long time. أَشْعَثْ أَغْبَرُ أَشْعَثْ means, you know, sort of like his hair is not groomed, which is a sign of long travel, you know, especially in the desert or, you know, in open fields and without the comforts of life that we have now. أَغْبَرُ means he's all dusty, hasn't taken a shower, hasn't bathed for a while. So this is a state of humility where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more likely to accept the dua. يَمُدُّ يَدَيْهِ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ Again, one of the etiquettes and the sunan of making dua is that you raise your hands. وَيَقُولْ يَا رَبِّ يَا رَبِّ Oh my Lord, my Creator, my Sustainer, my Cherisher. وَمَطْعَمُهُ حَرَامٌ وَمَلْبَسُهُ حَرَامٌ وَغُذِّيَ بِالْحَرَامِ فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ What he eats is either forbidden stuff or things that come from a forbidden source. وَمَشْرَبُهُ حَرَامٌ What he drinks is either haram, is forbidden, or the source of which is forbidden. وَمَلْبَسُهُ حَرَامٌ The garments that he has on his body are either haram in and of themselves, or they come from sources that are forbidden. Then the Prophet ﷺ says, فَأَنَّا يُسْتَجَابُ لَهُ In spite of adhering to all these sunnah and making the right dua, doing travel where dua is highly acceptable, in a state of humility where one feels just so desperate and so poor and so needy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala under these circumstances, the only thing that has prevented this person's dua from being accepted is the fact that he did not take the time to make sure to ascertain that the source of his sustenance, the source of his rizq, is halal. So these are among many, of course, we just in a nutshell mentioned, you know, the ibadat, and we mentioned the other 62 parts. And if you were to enumerate the other parts that prevent someone from entering, you know, paradise and wal'iyadu billah ended up at a loss in the hereafter. You know, shirk is one, we mentioned that. And here, more specifically, we're talking about the greater form of shirk. قتل النفس التي حرم الله إلا بالحق. Okay? Istibaha means to make lawful that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made unlawful in terms of shedding the sacred blood of a Muslim or even a non-Muslim unjustly. Okay? Practicing black magic, which is a form of shirk, because it requires to blasphemize the Quran or to disgrace Islam or to disgrace the Quran or to speak ill of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Akli riba, you know, dealing with riba, and all one's life is just entangled in riba. Practicing hypocrisy, wal'iyadu billah, which are mentioned at the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah in details. Worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon conditions. If you give me the risk, I'll worship you. If you test me, I drop out. And many, many other, you know, oppressing people. Where we said that, particularly for leaders, and there's so much oppression now. On Judgment Day, everyone will come and ask for, you know, عقوق الوالدين, okay, to not practice piety and righteousness. And the highest level of treatment, so is your parents. Abdullah ibn Abbas used to say, in a circle of knowledge, if someone here is عاقل والدين, let them not be with us. Why? Because our dua is not going to be accepted. So all these matters, you know, will prevent one's ibadah from being accepted and will yield our capital, رأس الأمر, the head of the matter, which is Islam, to be very vulnerable. And وَلِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ Part of the ayat of the Qur'an at the latter part of Surah Al-Kahf, which talk about the disbeliever, part of that could apply to us where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ هَلْ نَبِّيُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعِيُّهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا Shall we tell you about those who are at the greatest of loss? Those who've gone astray in this dunya and they're thinking they're doing well. So for someone just to perform Islam at the surface without understanding what they're doing or without understanding, you know, the higher value and the higher mission and the higher goal behind all these ibadat and behind believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and continue to engage themselves in acts of mischief, recklessness, negligence, lack of sense of responsibility towards that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in their custody, these people will take a share of this ayah, wal-iyadu billah, that they are misguided in this dunya, and they think that they are guided, and they think that they've got paradise guaranteed for them. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to the best of words, the words of wisdom, and follow the best of it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefits us, and to benefit us with that He taught us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in knowledge. اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما انك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد ان لا اله الا انت نستغفرك ونتوب اليك سبحان ربك رب العزه عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته